Okay. Erev Tov. The parasha is Ki Tissa. That's the name of the parasha. In this parasha, there's a terrible story that takes place. It's terrible, especially because I think that none of us here today could imagine that that could happen to us. You imagine, here's Am Yisrael. They've just confronted HaKadosh Baruch Hu, because they had this ultimate religious experience. Ultimate in a historical sense. So you think about everybody, when they try to describe for themselves what the ultimate religious experience was, they came up, every one of them, every generation, every religion, every community, they all said the same thing. The ultimate religious experience is cleaving to God. It's somehow recognizing the fact that you're standing before HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the realest kind of sense. And this just happened. It just happened to Am Yisrael. They stood at Har Sinai and they received the Torah. And the mitzvot that they learned about were God, something about God, that God is unique, there is no other. And the second thing that they learned was try not to or deny yourself the opportunity of making another image, another God. And here, B'nai Yisrael, that's what they did. They did it. It was somehow 40 days later. 40 days later, B'nai Yisrael, they stood at Har Sinai, waiting for Moshe Rabbeinu to return with the Torah, and they built a golden calf. Now it's, I don't know if you know that much about this parasha, but you know that the early commentaries, Chazal, they tried to minimize the nature of the idolatry involved. They say maybe, you know, like Jews have been able to talk about things throughout the ages. They say, well, maybe it was this, and maybe it was that, and maybe it wasn't exactly what you think it was. But in fact, it was as close to an idolatrous statement as we've ever imagined. It was as close to all of Am Yisrael, as close as Am Yisrael deciding to worship an idol as ever before. And in fact, I tell you this aside, this problem that B'nai Yisrael had with the golden calf remained with them. It remained part of their heritage, so to speak, an inability to deal with the reality as the Torah demanded all through the early part of Jewish history. I remind you, remember again, Shlomo, the second king of Israel, right? Actually, the third. The first king of Israel's name was Shaul. Yes? Shaul. The second king of Israel, or maybe the first king of Israel, depending on how you count, was David HaMelech. David HaMelech had a son whose name was Shlomo. Shlomo HaMelech built the Beit HaMikdash. I mean, it's true David HaMelech started it, but Shlomo HaMelech did it. He built it. And in order to build the Beit HaMikdash, I'm just telling you what it says in the Tanakh. In order to build the Beit HaMikdash, he had to tax the people. I mean, you can't build something without somebody paying for it. And even in those days, you couldn't build the Beit HaMikdash, not the way Shlomo HaMelech envisioned it, if there wasn't a serious tax. After Shlomo HaMelech died, or when Shlomo HaMelech died, the people came to his son And they said to his son, whose name was Rechavam, they said to Rechavam, we can't afford to pay the tax. We can't keep paying the tax. You have to lighten the burden. We can't live. We work and we pay the tax. Rechavam, in a less than diplomatic manner, said, what? I like the tax. In fact, I'll make even more tax so that I could live a better life, Rechavam. And because of that, there was a revolution. There was a revolution, and the northern tribes, meaning north of Yerushalayim, the tribes that were north of Yerushalayim decided to split off and create a kingdom, which was called unromantically the Northern Kingdom. So there was in Eretz Yisrael the Southern Kingdom, that was also called Yehuda, and there was the Northern Kingdom that was called Israel. Very good. And in the Northern Kingdom, there was a new king, a second king. Rechavam was the king in Yehuda. And in Israel, there was another king whose name was Yeravam ben Nevat. Good. Terrific. We're alive and well. Yeravam ben Nevat, even though he turned out to be a terrible person, and so indicated in the Gemara at the end of Sanhedrin, Yeravam ben Nevat was a legitimate king of Israel, anointed by a Navi, by a prophet whose name was, is a little tricky, right? Achiah HaShiloni. Achiah HaShiloni. I was never good on quizzes, so they shouldn't bother you at all. Achiah HaShiloni anointed Yeravam ben Nevat. Yeravam ben Nevat, therefore, was a legitimate king of Israel. He wasn't a usurper. He was a king. He turned out to be a terrible person. So Yeravam ben Nevat, he looked around and he said, I have a problem. All the Jews, when it comes to Yontif, or when it comes to bringing Korbanot, or comes to bringing chataot, they all go to Yerushalayim. He says, how are we going to kind of have an independent country if everybody in our country, in the north, goes to Yerushalayim, which is part of the south, in order to do whatever they have to do with their religious duties are? Question. So Yeravam came up with this brilliant idea. And he said, I'm going to make a competitive Beit HaMikdash. Not only will I make a competitive Beit HaMikdash, but I'm going to make two of them. Two. One in Beit El and one in Dan. And since you all live here or have been around, you know that in the north means every place north of Yerushalayim, right? The north of the north is Dan. Probably have visited the waters that are connected to Dan, and the south of the north is Beit El. North of the north is Dan, the south of the north is Beit El. So Yeravam ben Nevat decided to build temples in the north of the north and the south of the north so that the people of the north wouldn't have to go to Yerushalayim. But then they said to him, Yeravam, Adoni HaMelech, what is going to make our Mikdash competitive with the Mikdash in Yerushalayim? I'm Yerushalayim. They have an Aron and they have a Menorah and they have a Shulchan and they have Kohanim. How are we going to compete with that? What is going to draw people to the Mikdash that we built in Dan and Beersheba? You know what Yeravam said? We'll build a golden calf. And we'll put a golden calf in Dan. And we'll put a golden calf in Beersheba. And then everybody will know that this is serious. So even though I can't explain it, even though I don't understand it. Yeravam ben Nevat knew his people, and he knew that they would be affected by the building of a golden calf, just as the Jews leaving Mitzrayim had it somehow in their genetic makeup. A golden calf, that's really something. And that's what they did. And that's the story in the parasha of Ki Tissa that we are relating to. Why? Why were they forgiven by HaKadosh Baruch Hu for what they did? Why was it that Moshe Rabbeinu was able to defend them? What sort of defense could you muster for such an act? Remember, Moshe Rabbeinu was on Har Sinai receiving the Torah. Bnei Yisrael had just gone through what in English is called theophany, like this meeting with God at Har Sinai where they found out that they're going to get the Torah. And then they go and they build this golden calf. And they worshiped that golden calf. And they sang around and they danced and they were happy. And they made a holiday out of it. Can you imagine? You imagine, and then Moshe Rabbeinu goes to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and says something, and they are forgiven. The whole story doesn't quite jive. Doesn't quite make sense. So look at a pasuk. A pasuk that really doesn't make sense. There's a pasuk in our parasha. Moshe Rabbeinu is making his argument. You remember the argument that Moshe Rabbeinu made, which we, you know, you go to shul, you hear the argument, you know, in Tanit Zibur. Moshe Rabbeinu said, oh, you know, people are going to say that HaKadosh Baruch Hu was not able to take them out of Mitzrayim, and so they died in the desert. I wouldn't say that that is kind of a real defense of Am Yisrael, but that's what Moshe Rabbeinu said. But it didn't work. It wasn't good enough. And finally, there's a concluding argument by Moshe Rabbeinu in this parasha. There's a concluding argument to which Moshe Rabbeinu says, this is it. And that's our pasuk. So if you look, it says in the pasuk, Vavta. Ata means now. Now means I'm about to say something very important. This is Moshe Rabbeinu talking to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Moshe Rabbeinu talked to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, says, Ata. Tisa, the Hebrew word is to bear the weight. If you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, will bear the weight of their sin. You have to add, as Rashi always says, sometimes you have to add words in a pasuk. So you have to add the words, okay. Again. Im tisa chatata. Moshe Rabbeinu says to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if you bear the burden of their sin, meaning if you forgive them, adding words, the two words we add are okay. That's Moshe Rabbeinu's argument with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. If you forgive them, great. Vim ayin. But if you don't forgive them, or if you don't agree to forgive them, Mecheni na misifrecha asher katavta. Please, just don't tell me you understand what that says. I mean, what kind of argument could that possibly be? What is mecheni na misifrecha? First of all, what's the sifrecha? We don't even know there was exactly a sefer, even though Rashi says that there was a sefer already. Moshe Rabbeinu just came down from Har Sinai with the Aseret Dibrot, with the Luchot, with these tablets, which he threw down and he broke them because, of course, he had no one to give them to. There was no one who could hold them. There was no one who was innocent, really, at that moment. So listen again. Moshe Rabbeinu is making the ultimate argument, the argument that comes after every other argument that he could make. And he says, Moshe Rabbeinu says, Im tisachatatam, okay. if you will bear with them, if you will forgive them, if you will let Jewish history go on, and not as HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to Moshe Rabbeinu, oh, we'll get rid of all of them, and we'll start over again. And instead of Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, we'll have Avram, Yitzchak, Yaakov, Moshe Rabbeinu. And Moshe Rabbeinu will be the father of the nation. And that was the suggestion made by HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Moshe Rabbeinu says, no, I reject that suggestion. And he says, Im Tissa Chatatam, if you will forgive them, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but Im Ayin, if you're not going to forgive them, Mecheni Nami Sifricha Asher Katavta. This is what is called a non sequitur. And in school, if you're in the fourth grade or the fifth grade, and you write something that the teacher takes a red pen and makes an X, non sequiturs are no good because they don't make sense. And this doesn't make sense. Why would Moshe Rabbeinu say to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Mecheni nami sifricha shekatavta? What sort of an argument is that in favor of erase me from the book which you have written? How and what way does that defend B'nai Yisrael? How does that guarantee their continued existence? How does that give them life? I mean, you have to, in order to understand the answer to the question, in order to understand the way that Rabbi Nachman of Breslav understood this pasuk, we have to understand something about Moshe Rabbeinu. What was Moshe Rabbeinu's job? What was his position? Do you have an idea? We all know that Moshe Rabbeinu's job, so to speak, was to bring B'nai Yisrael from Mitzrayim to Har Sinai to Eretz Canaan. That was his job. But that doesn't tell me really what his job was. Because was he like a coach in a basketball team? Like trying to get the team to do the right thing, but if he failed, you just kick him out and get another one? Was that Moshe Rabbeinu? You remember when Moshe Rabbeinu discussed his job with a Kodesh Baruch Hu standing at the Sneh? Sneh. The snare that was burning, the burning bush that was not consumed, Moshe Rabbeinu said, I don't want to go. Why did Moshe Rabbeinu, do you think Moshe Rabbeinu said, I don't want to go? Why did he say, send somebody else? Why did he say, I don't speak clearly? I've had problems with convincing people all my life. Moshe Rabbeinu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, no. It's you, you're going. It's your job. You've got the job. And finally, he was convinced. It's true, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, Aaron will help you out. But Moshe Rabbeinu finally was convinced. So it's hard for us to understand. What do you mean you have an argument with God? And then after you have an argument with God, you agree? I mean, you agree. I mean, why didn't you agree at the beginning? Why didn't you agree at the end? Why didn't you agree at the beginning? So that, I think that the simple pshat is, you know what simple pshat is? It's what I think. Everything else is complicated. The simple pshat is that Moshe Rabbeinu didn't want a job. He wanted a position that guaranteed success. He said to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I don't want to be the tour guide. I'm not the one to be a person who tells them go to the left or go to the right where they leave Mitzrayim. I want to make sure that I'm the person who's going to bring them to Eretz Canaan, or bring them first to Har Sinai and then to Eretz Canaan. Now, HaKadosh Baruch Hu said yes. Yes meaning that you will be successful. You'll be successful. Now, look at Rav Nachman. Now you have to, if you understand that, if you're following, look at Rav Nachman. You see it's on the page, the bottom part of the sheet. Rav Nachman said this. Bishvil zeh, I mean, it's continuing an idea that we don't have time for today. But bishvil zeh, it says, Sheit palel Moshe al chait העגל אמר, אם תיסח חטאתם ועם עין, מכני נא. Okay, Rav Nachman is going to explain this pasuk, which we have just looked at, right? The argument that Moshe Rabbeinu made in order to ensure that Am Yisrael would be redeemed at this time. Ki zeh min hanimna. It is impossible, Rav Nachman says. Shelo yavo la'adam eze gadlut. People suffer from achieving greatness. Kishumeya shemisapring shivcho. People, when they hear others speak of them highly, what a great person he is. What a great achiever he is. What a great Talmid Chacham he is. When you speak about a person like that, ki ze min hanimna, I'm going back to the beginning of the line, shelo yavo la'adam eze gadlut. It's inconceivable that if a person is looked upon as being a great person, kishishomea shemisaprim shivcho, when he hears people talking about him, and they say, oh, what a wonderful person. What a high achiever. What a righteous individual. Kol shekein, certainly, kishemelech gadol mishabeach umifa'eret ha'adam. Certainly this is true if a person was complimented by a king. Complimented by a king. Of course, here the metaphor is Moshe Rabbeinu, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, a person, the king. So if that person is complimented, if his righteousness, if his spiritual uniqueness is raised on a banner, if you say, oh boy, what a person he is, Bifa'eret Adam, Azai Bivadai Min Hanimna. Azai bevadai min hanimna. Translated, it's inconceivable, right? It's not possible. It cannot happen. Shelo yavo lo eze gadlut. Hear the word gadlut? Lack of humility. It's impossible, Rav Nachman says, to withstand praise. It's impossible for a person not to be affected by compliments of an extreme sort. And certainly, if the king compliments you, the king says, oh, there's something special about you. If HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes to Moshe Rabbeinu and says, you'll be the leader, you'll take them out of Mitzrayim, or if HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to Moshe Rabbeinu, let's do away with this people, with this group, and you will become the father of a new nation. So those compliments affect that person. Like you say, gee, I'm really something. I'm really special. There's no one else quite like me. It's impossible for you to avoid that. Shelo yevolo eze gadlut, lack of humility. Aval tzarich laze bitul kol hargashatav vechamriyotav. In order to deal with that, in order to deal with this frightening thing where you become a personification of the lack of humility, you have to deal with it. You have to drive out that feeling that you have. You have to like keep yourself under control, hargashotav, his feelings, v'chamriyotav, and the physicality of him, which likes that. You like the idea that people say, oh, you look good. Somebody told me that tonight, but I didn't believe them. Azai yachol ha'adam lishmoa shivcho v'lo yavolo shum gadlut. He says, if you keep yourself under control, if you have some kind of, you're disciplined, if you're able to say to yourself, okay, this is the way of talking, it's just the way of speaking, it doesn't mean anything, it doesn't really mean that I am special because I have the problems that I have and I'm the person who I am. And as such, I'm always fighting, you know, in the way of the Tanya. I'm always fighting to justify myself and who I am. He says, L'shmoa shifcho, v'lo yavo lo shum gadlut, so he can hear that he's special, but he doesn't lose his humility. And I use that word advisedly. He doesn't use that advisedly. Kamosh Moshe Rabbeinu, shira'a katuv ba'Torah, v'yedabe Hashem el Moshe, v'yoma Hashem el Moshe. Okay, before we explain it, or that line, I want to remind you of the fact. I want to remind you of the fact that when God created man, the Pasuk says, Nase Adam b'tzalmeinu v'chidmuteinu. Yes? You remember that? And so the problem that people, that everybody relates to, is why did it say na'ase plural? Na'ase b'tzalmeinu. We will make. Who's we? Who is we? So you know, if you remember, that the Ibn Ezra is the one who said, pluralis majestatis. There's such a thing. When you want to impress people and you're speaking English, American English, say a word in Latin. Somebody told me that once. So there you have it. The plural of the king. You know, when the king talks, also the queen. But when the king talks, he says, we are going to sleep. He doesn't say, I am going to sleep, because that would be embarrassing and insulting to think that the king was like everybody else. But the king says, we. So that means, why does the pasuk say, Nase Adam? Nase means the king. King is a Kadosh Baruch Hu. Who made man? Kadosh Baruch Hu made man. But Rashi takes a different tact. Rashi says this. Anvitanuto shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu hizot. Humility. It's God's humility. God said, looked around and saw the heavenly hosts, and he said to the heavenly hosts, whoever they are, said to the heavenly hosts, let's make a man. Let's agree to make a man. And that was humility. So why does God have to be humble for the heavenly hosts? So I think that what Rashi meant to say was, that God created humility. Why did God create the humility? Because humility is the weapon that man was given in order to preserve his achievement. When Moshe Rabbeinu died, the Torah eulogized him. Very short eulogy. Anav mikol Adam. The most humble of all the people. What does that mean? That he was the most, what does it mean that he was the most humble? Does it mean that he didn't know he had value? That he took the Jews out of Mitzrayim? That he brought them right to the edge of Eretz Canaan? No, he knew all that. He knew he was valuable. He knew that nobody else could do what he had done. Humility means that he had reference points that enabled him to maintain his equilibrium. He had stood before God. You know, when you stand before God, you're not that interested in the seat that you sit in shul. Right? When you stand before God, it doesn't matter that much how much you spent on buying your house or a car or whatever it is you like to spend money on. That's called anava. Anava, humility, is the way you place yourself within the greater context. And the greater context is, close to God, closer to God, further from God. That's the context. So Moshe Rabbeinu, I'm referencing the previous discussion. Moshe Rabbeinu knew that God had appointed him in order to lead Bnei Yisrael and bring them to Mitzrayim. And since God appointed Moshe Rabbeinu, he couldn't fail. Moshe Rabbeinu really couldn't understand what was going on. He looked around and he said, why are we having this difficulty? Why is it that I am unable to guarantee the safety of Am Yisrael on their way to Eretz Canaan? I, after all, am appointed by HaKadosh Baruch Hu to bring them to Eretz Canaan. It should not be a question. It shouldn't be an issue. There shouldn't be a problem. And yet there is a problem. So along comes Rabbi Nachman of Breslav. And Rabbi Nachman of Breslav said, V'lo yavolo shun gadlut, that a person can protect himself against this lack of humility, k'mosh Moshe Rabbeinu, shera'a, the end of the fourth line. You see the fourth line? You count 1, 2, 3, 4. The end of that line, the last three words, Moshe. Everybody knows that there are many psukim in the Torah that don't seem to have a content. But they are. They say, Vaydaber Hashem el Moshe, Vaydaber Hashem el Moshe, Leymor, Vaydaber Hashem el Moshe, Daber el Bnei Yisrael, Vaydaber Hashem again and again and again. So Moshe Rabbeinu said, if I have trouble leading Bnei Yisrael, if I'm problematic in creating an environment where Am Yisrael will get certainly to Eretz Canaan, it must be because I've lost some element of leadership. I'm messed up. So Moshe Rabbeinu said, I just was at Har Sinai. What could that have been? What was it that caused me to lose the edge of leadership? He says, I looked into the Torah, and it says again and again, Vayomer Hashem el Moshe Lemor. It says it again and again and again. And it seems to be an unnecessary, an otios verse. Unnecessary in that it doesn't contain any particular content. So you have all these psukim in the Torah that just say, Moshe Rabbeinu. That's all they say. He says, it must be that I have become, my humility has been dulled. The edge has been taken off of my ability to be humble before God, because I appear again and again in the Torah. It's like somebody with an album and sees picture again and again. So look at that, and look at that. It's like a wedding album. Of course, it's changed. In my day, I think we got married, you got 100 pictures. Now you get 2,000 pictures. So I said, if you have 2,000 pictures, it take you a week to look at your pictures, just to look at them. So that could produce a lack of humility, without a doubt. I mean, the same people are in the middle of every picture. It's like a little bit, you know. So Moshe Rabbeinu says, it must be that something about me, which enabled me to be Moshe Rabbeinu, has been affected by what I did on Har Sinai, by the Torah that I saw, the psukim that were written, and the fact that Moshe Rabbeinu's name is stated again and again and again. And therefore, Moshe Rabbeinu said to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I want to be Moshe Rabbeinu. I want to be the person who's going to take them out of Mitzrayim and bring them to Eretz Yisrael. I want to be the person who will do it with certainty, who will definitely succeed. And therefore, Kodesh Baruch Hu, Moshe Rabbeinu said, Kama, Mecheni na misifricha. Just erase me. Erase my name. I don't want my name to be in the parasha again and again and again, because that's causing me, obviously, great distress. unhappiness and the inability to go on. Before we finish, Rabbi Nachman, I want to tell you something about this pasuk. You see in the middle, there's a source in the middle, a pasuk, the first pasuk. Are you still with me? Here I am. You can't do that on television. Now you can do it. We do that. I mean, I do it on the web yeshiva, but no one pays attention. It says in last week's parasha is called Titzaveh, right? Titzaveh. And starts with these words, Vata Titzaveh B'nei Yisrael. Ata, a pronoun referring to you, Moshe Rabbeinu. Ata Titzaveh B'nei Yisrael. But it doesn't have Moshe Rabbeinu's name. Just Ata. So in the commentary called the Baal HaTurim, you know, when he wasn't busy writing his great work, the Tur Shulchan Aruch, he wrote a commentary on the Chumash, so it was easy. So his commentary on the Chumash was a commentary on the Mesorah. I'm sorry I said that, because I can't explain exactly what the Mesorah was right now. I think I could explain it, but I don't think now I'm going to do it now. Listen to what the Baal HaTurim said. You see it? Lo hizkir Moshe bazeh haseder. The name Moshe is not listed in this parasha. Seder means parasha. V'zeh she'ein kein b'chol hachumash. Shemisha'ah shenolad Moshe ein seder shelo huzkar ba. And so the Baal HaTurim says this is a little odd, because every single parasha, starting from the parasha of Shmot, the first parasha of the book of Shmot, where Moshe Rabbeinu is born, every parasha until the end of the Torah mentions Moshe Rabbeinu except for this one, except for Tetzaveh. That's pretty good, no? Like, he had that kind of memory. He knew that. V'atam, how come Moshe Rabbeinu's name appears in every single parasha, but not in this one, Tetzaveh? Question. Answer. V'atam, the last word on the second line. V'atam, mishum she'amar mecheinina misifricha shekatavta. Since Moshe Rabbeinu said, mecheinina, we know that pasuk. He said, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, erase me from the Sefer Torah. And that's quoted in several places, and we know the Gemara says Kilelat Chacham Afilu Al Tnai Ba'a. Kilelat Chacham, an interdiction by a great scholar. Something happens, even if it's Al Tnai, even if it's conditional, and the condition is not fulfilled, and you didn't have to do it. It's still there's a remnant. So Moshe Rabbeinu said, Mecheni na misifricha, so it appears someplace, right? It appears that it can't go unnoticed. It's like if Moshe Rabbeinu said something and then nothing happened. So even though HaKadosh Baruch Hu responds to Moshe Rabbeinu, you see the second pasuk, the top group of psukim, Vayom Hashem el Moshe, Mi asher chata li emchenu misifri. Oh, no, I'm not going to erase you, Moshe Rabbeinu. You're okay. But I'll erase whoever sinned. We don't know who that is, but that's the response. So according to the Baal HaTurim, what's left is the statement of Moshe Rabbeinu, mecheni na misifricha, and that took place in the parasha of Tetzaveh, last week's parasha, where Moshe Rabbeinu's name is not mentioned. It's a kind of mecheni na, erase me, b'ze'er anpin, miniature. It's a miniature mecheni na mesifricha. Let's go back to Rabbi Nachman. If you look at the sixth line, the fifth word, Vayomer Hashem el Moshe. Right? Vayomer Hashem leMoshe, Moshe Rabbeinu said, erase my name. Give me back my humility. Make me the great leader that I was destined to be. Allow me to make sure that Bnei Yisrael will continue their trek in history to go to Eretz Canaan. V'Yisrael korim b'chol yom b'Torah shivcho shel Moshe. And Bnei Yisrael think of the Torah as the gift of Moshe Rabbeinu v'hu ba'atzmo misaper lahem shebachav v'lo haya l'Moshe shum hitpa'arut v'gadlut mizeh. And Moshe Rabbeinu maintained his humility. It wasn't removed from him. He didn't achieve glory and greatness. Kimoshe katuv v'aish Moshe anav me'od. Right, Moshe Rabbeinu was very humble, meaning that was the distinguishing feature. And that's what a hesped is. A hesped is not storytelling about the person who died, but a hesped is an attempt to encapsulate the person in an idea, in a moment, in a sentence. And that's La'ish Moshe Anav Me'od. Ubevadai al yedei anvetanuto. And because he had this midah, this quality of humility, which comes from Nase Adam b'tzalmenu chidmutenu. Who is an Adam? Who is it that HaKadosh Baruch Hu was thinking about? So Rashi says, anvetanuto shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu hizo. It's the midah. It's the quality of humility. Ayakoch biyad Moshe lechaper avon ha'egel. And this is what made it possible for Moshe Rabbeinu to cause atonement even for the chet of ha'egel, of the golden calf, as great as that chet might have been. V'lo ayal Moshe, k'mo shekatuv v'ish Moshe anav me'od, u'bevadai al yedei anvetanuto. Because of this humility, ayakoch biyad Moshe lechaper avon ha'egel. He was able to do it. He was able to pull it off. K'mo shekatuv v'ish chacham yichaprena ze sheta'an Moshe v'im ayin, haynu im lo tisach atatam. He explains the pasuk again. Im tisach atatam v'im ayin. But if you don't, he says to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, haynu im lo tisach atatam, baze atam ar'eh. In that way you show she'ein li kol kach anivut she'uchal lekaper lehen avon ha'egel b'chein pakashati. Because you're actually saying, he says to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you're saying, I don't have it. I lost it. I lost whatever it is you have to be Moshe Rabbeinu to have the humility necessary to lead Bnei Yisrael. And so, makashati, what I ask is, b'cheinina, erase me, kidei shelo ekashel begadlut, that I will not stumble on the sin of lack of humility, thinking I have greatness. Sh'ani ro'eh v'shamea b'chol eit, Sipur Shemi B'Shivchi B'Torah, that I listen all the time. Everybody's reading from the Torah. They keep saying, "Vayedaber Hashem el Moshe Lemor, Ki mi yuchal amot bazeh." Who could protect himself from this oppression? Sheyishama Sipur Shivcho B'Lo Yitga'eh. I mean, who could possibly see his name in the Torah and not lack humility as a result? Im lo anav gadol, you have to really be very humble. Vim ani anav tzarich lecha shetisach atatam. And if I am humble, then you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, have to forgive them. Vover al pesha l'sheirit, and God forgives those who are left. V'zeh v'hi v'shu'un melech, ha'ini sh'malchut ala l'shorasha. This is the true meaning of the kingship of God, this ability that God has to forgive. So, if we asked, who was Moshe Rabbeinu? Moshe Rabbeinu was not the leader of Bnei Yisrael in the sense that we think today about leadership, but Moshe Rabbeinu was the insurance policy of Am Yisrael. It was almost as if the Torah is telling us if they could be a Moshe Rabbeinu, that itself justifies the existence of Am Yisrael. Yes, not perfect, not yet perfect, but Moshe Rabbeinu. I mean, that kind of leadership never existed before and changed the way we understand the march of Am Yisrael through history. And so Moshe Rabbeinu had difficulty understanding why it was that he was on the breach of failure. And in the way of true leadership, he accepted the responsibility. He said, it must be my fault. There must be something about me which doesn't match up to the qualities necessary to be the true leader of Am Yisrael. And therefore, Moshe Rabbeinu looked around and he said, what could it have been? I mean, we know that Moshe Rabbeinu suffered indignities, but he did not change his way. The humility that he inherited was with him all the time. It wasn't that everybody recognized it. Even his sister, his brother, they had difficulties at times in understanding who Moshe Rabbeinu really was. And actually was. But Moshe Rabbeinu was not deterred. He went in his way, humbling himself, understanding that his experience was way beyond what anybody else could give him. And so he looked around and he said, it must be this odd fact that I appear so many times in God's Torah. And that must be what's turning my head, what's making me feel that the special humility that I used to have must be failing. There must be some chinks in my armor. And so Moshe Rabbeinu, again, as a leader, as a true leader, he said to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, "Bicheni na misifricha." Because it's more important that I lead Bnei Yisrael to Eretz Canaan than anything else, than any other job that I might have, than any other responsibility that I might have. So mecheni na, as much as I wish that I didn't have to do this, obviously, there's got to be some way of returning me to my position as the leader of Am Yisrael. And so Rav Nachman teaches us that yes, there was a struggle. Moshe Rabbeinu was part of the struggle of leadership for Am Yisrael. Can you regain it? Can you hold on to it? Can you hold on to anava? Can you hold on to humility in spite of everything that happens in the world? And Moshe Rabbeinu was the model who was able to do it. And that's what the Torah meant when it eulogized Moshe Rabbeinu and said, anav, we call it more humble than any other person, because he was willing to sacrifice his humility for the goodness of Am Yisrael. HaKadosh Baruch Hu turned back to Moshe Rabbeinu and said, no, it's not your fault. And therefore, it is possible to forgive Bnei Yisrael for building the golden calf. Bnei Yisrael was forgiven for building the calf and continued to live and got to Eretz Canaan. But as we said earlier on, Yeravam ben Nevat did not forget this inclination that Bnei Yisrael had for the golden calf and try to dissuade them from Yerushalayim unsuccessfully, Baruch Hashem. And eventually the northern kingdom dissolved and disappeared, and we were left only with Yerushalayim, and Yerushalayim became the center of all of Eretz Yisrael. And hopefully somehow humility will return to Am Yisrael. A little hard to find humility in the time of elections, but who knows, maybe. All the best. Have a good Shabbos.
למה הוא עשה עגל?
זה היה... לא, אני אומר שאותה שאלה, למה הם עשו עגל בהתחלה?
הם עשו עגל כי הם עשו עגל.
לא, זה היה בתוכם, הם למדו את זה אולי.